report.
What's happening, Heather?
Alpha team isn't responding.
Bravo?
Still nothing.
You lost both teams? Get a grip on this operation, Heather. That's Bourne. Green light the asset.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time. Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth. There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne. And it is Thursday, July 28th, 2016. And I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning into Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. And to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud, as well as the next day on Stitcher and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we're happy to hear from you. You can reach us via phone, 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664, or via Skype. Just send a contact request to Nonpartisan Liberty for all one word. And check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, which has links to our Facebook page, as well as other social media, archives, pictures, lots of other stuff. Also, a way to donate to the show if you feel so inclined to donate to the show. And original articles and blogs also. So there is a lot I want to talk about today. Before I get into that, one of the things I wanted to mention, and this had happened before and I mentioned it on the show, I don't remember which application it had happened with, but I had all my shows downloaded. And I don't know if it was even all the shows, but it was a large amount of shows were downloaded. And I can see where they're downloaded from, or I can see a breakdown of the cities and percentages of like the top cities. So I noticed that those shows were downloaded from Ashburn, Virginia. So I look up Ashburn, Virginia. Of course, it's a suburb of D.C., or it's like right next to D.C., meaning Washington, D.C., where, of course, all of the government agencies are. So I assume it's probably somebody who works for the government or the government downloading the shows. I actually think at that point, though, it wasn't a download of all the shows. It was a high percentage of listens from Ashburn, Virginia. And So that's why I don't think I was as, not that I'm concerned or anything like that, but I was as sure that it was the government as I am now, and I'll explain why. But I had thought, well, Ashburn, Virginia, it just so happens to be right near D.C., and there's all these listens coming from there, and I don't know anybody in Ashburn, Virginia. It doesn't mean I don't have people that come across the show and listen. I know I do because I see cities that I obviously don't know people in, and they come across the show and listen, whether they, you know, listen once or they come across it and like it and listen to it occasionally or listen to it most shows. I don't know if the listens I get, if I have a lot of people that try to listen whenever they can that are fans, or it just ends up that the show comes across certain people, however it comes across them, whether they're on one of the applications that I'm on or somebody shares a show or something like that. I can't really tell how many repeat people I get or how many are new people or whatever. I can tell the majority of the, or the percentages of like the top cities and how many people are listening and things like that. And I can't even exactly tell how many people are listening, just because right now, if you listen through the website, my actual website, where I only post on the weekend, I don't know if you listen, because that's not linked to anything. If you listen on the website, like now, like live, if you're listening right now through the website, through the embedded link there, then that I know, because Spreaker will pick it up. But when I actually post a file and archive it that way, which I try to do every weekend, I won't know if you're listening to it. And I tried to coded a while ago where I would know, and then I never got back to that, so I need to actually do that. But anyway, I had noticed in the past couple weeks, it might have even been more recent than that, that every iTunes show I have, because I noticed you can, you know, see each show how many listens you have, but you can also see like how many listens you have for the week, because it might be that people are listening to your old shows, or they're like a week behind or a couple weeks behind or something like that. And I have the type of show that really you can listen. I've mentioned this before, and part of this is just on purpose. Part of it is just because it's the type of shows I like to do. I like to talk about topics, and many of the things I talk about are still relevant even in a couple months. So they're not necessarily things that if you listen to 2 months from now, that it's not relevant or there's no point, because I'm not doing really a news show. I'll integrate news into it to possibly support something or talk about an example of something that has happened. And occasionally I'll talk about news, but it's more of a topical show where I talk about different topics relating to promoting freedom. So it makes sense that somebody would listen to a show a couple weeks old or even longer than that. And it definitely stays relevant. So I don't know if people realize that, but people that have heard the show probably do and think, yeah, I can listen to the, I never heard this show, this sounds interesting. And the way I even word the titles, I think you can tell that it's more just a topical show and that, well, I want to listen to something that covers this topic and it doesn't matter that it's 2 months old. Anyway, I can see the listens as a whole for a week, which may vary from the listens that I got for the shows I did that week. So, for example, I could get 60 listens or less to the two shows because I missed yesterday, and I apologize for that. But the two shows I did this week, I could get 60 or 70 listens between the two of them, but I could get 200 listens or 300 listens as a whole to all my shows. I'm not saying that's what happens. I'm just using that as an example. So for some reason, I was just looking at it and I saw that for last week or the week before, I had like a ridiculous amount of listens. And then I noticed that I had 340, something like that. And that's around where we're at show wise, that were downloaded from iTunes. And they were downloaded from Ashburg, Virginia. So you look at like that day, it's all in one day. You look at that day, the percentage of listens, you have like 90 something percent are Ashburn, Virginia, and the rest are, you know, 1%, 2%, whatever. It might have even been a day that I wasn't on. So it's really hard to believe that somebody sitting right next to DC would download every show I've ever done. Now, if there is such a person that has nothing to do with the government and they're actually a fan and they did that, hey, that would be great. If anybody actually downloaded all my shows, that would be great. But I seriously doubt that would happen. And the other side of that is I don't know that I would want everybody downloading all my shows because the first, I don't know how many, kind of sucked anyway. Especially until I started, I got my new equipment and started on Spreaker and then was, I was still on Blog Talk Radio, but I was like uploading a file. So the only time it sounded shitty was when it was live. And then if you listen to the archives, you hear the good audio because I'd upload a file. But there's no way. I mean, it's like a 99.9% chance that somebody downloaded all of those on purpose that works for the government, I would think. I mean, I don't think I'm being paranoid in what I'm saying. I mean, it makes sense in what I talk about and the place it is. If it was in Las Vegas, I still probably think it was like the Fusion Center or something, or Las Vegas Police or something like that, but I don't know that it would stand out like it did, being that it was in Virginia. And Virginia is a pretty big state, but it wasn't like way out 2 hours away from D.C. It literally, from what I understood, is like, you know, 10 minutes from D.C. It's like it's a suburb of D.C. So what that means, I don't know. They could automatically download them and run them through a machine that looks for certain keywords or something and then look at stuff more closely. If they honestly have somebody listening to every single show, that's very sad. I don't believe I've ever said anything that would even warrant concern, never mind, you know, I know I've never said anything illegal. Well, they can say whatever they want is illegal, so. But as far as what has been written down in law, I've never said anything illegal. I'm conscious of what I say. Don't think I'm not. So there's certain things I say where I push things, but I know how far to push things. So I'm very conscious of that when I'm talking about certain things, and actually what I'm talking about tonight as well. So, and I had mentioned that a former friend who was on the show, who's a fuckhead, fucking loser, just because he's a backstabbing piece of shit. Anyway, that he claims, I don't even know if I believe him now, to be honest, but he claims he was questioned by the Fusion Center people. He didn't say Fusion Center people. He described the people that he was questioned by, and I had said those are the Fusion Center people. He also said that he taped it and he never played it for me. I don't know why you wouldn't play that, especially if, well, I guess if he didn't tell them that he was taping it, that is a crime. But if he did, which that's what he said, so that he had told them that he was recording it for his records or whatever, and they probably were recording it as well, why wouldn't you play the tape? Because it's your personal property and you have the right to play it. So I really don't think a tape exists, and I'm not sure that the actual conversation exists anymore. At the time, I did, but I don't know that it does. But that's what he claims. So we talked a lot about that on the show before. I don't know why he would lie about it, but you just, there were certain things at the time that I was like, didn't sound right. So I don't know. He could have lied about it. He could not have. Who knows? So anyway, all I know is that in Ashburg, Virginia, they downloaded 300 and something files from YouTube of my show, which is a DC suburb. So if there's any fans out there that actually live in Ashburg, Virginia, and you're the one who downloaded all the files, please, you know, call into the show or send me an email and tell me it was you. Of course, that could be the government doing that as well. But if I talk to that person, I could probably tell. If they just emailed me, I'm not going to be able to tell from an email. So, but call in the show and come on the air, and then you can compliment me and say why you did that. But I'm pretty sure it's the government downloading all those shows, and which is surprising because I'm not big at all. I'm starting to get more because of some of the apps. Like, I'm starting to get a lot more likes on Twitter and SoundCloud and some of the other apps that I didn't post a show on before. So that's helping, but it's still not a huge amount. And I don't know, Spreaker supposedly is supposed to pick all those up, but I know for a fact they didn't pick up all the SoundCloud plays because I had between SoundCloud and YouTube, I had like over 100 plays on one show. It was a Pablo Escobar show, and that's probably why people saw Pablo Escobar and they wanted to listen to the show. And there were 70 something on SoundCloud alone, and it didn't transfer over to Spreaker, which it's supposed to pick it up. So maybe it doesn't pick up SoundCloud. I know it says it picks up YouTube, but it can take up to 48 hours. So I don't know. And it did pick up iTunes because that's how I got that information on all the downloads on iTunes, is I got it from Spreaker. So not to confuse everybody with all these names of all these applications. But and also, I noticed that when I search for stuff, those results have gotten better. They're still not great, but there's a lot of people with my name, actually. So if you just put my name in, it doesn't really give you shit. If you put the name of the show in, you get a lot of stuff, and you get actually the website. So I think it's the second or third result. So that's pretty good. And if you put in my name in Las Vegas, you get a lot of stuff too. So that's and there's other David Bournes in Las Vegas. So that's pretty good also. But the show still is nowhere near where I want it to be. And I look at YouTube and how many views people get, and people that, some of them are terrible, and they talk about how, well, you know, I just started doing YouTube videos, and there's like 300,000 views. I'm like, how does somebody, is that because people keep watching it over and over again? How does somebody get 300,000 or 400,000 views on YouTube by just being some regular person who posted a video? And these are like, you know, 5 to 10 minute to 20 minute videos that you'll see. And it's just surprising. And I mean, with the stuff I'm posting on YouTube now, is it's just a show, and it's not even any video or any of that. And so I don't expect to really get a lot from YouTube. And it's also, you know, at least a minimum of 2 hours. So really what I should do is at some point go to a format where I'm filming the show, and then I can cut it up and have small bits from the show and see how that does, and if that actually increases the amount of views, which I'd be happy with, like 1,000 views. Jesus. So anyway, it's not like the show is that big, but I don't think that matters, because when they look at these lone wolf lunatics, they don't seem to be very popular or have shows neither. So I guess it would be the same concept. But anyway, so tonight I wanted to talk about a number of things, but really the things that I think are the most important when it comes to freedom, as well as how I think things should be. Of course, I don't believe in a government, but even with a government, things that should happen in a society, in our current society. And a lot of them, I know that they're just not going to happen. And I think most of them, they're not going to happen, and they're not going to happen through the system. And we'll get into that. So, I want to talk about that, but I was thinking about earlier when I woke up, because I took a nap before the show, and yes, I missed yesterday's show because I was just so tired, and I've been really tired. And I think about, why do I do the show? I don't make any money off it. I don't have the numbers that I look at and say, hey, you know, that's great. I'm doing really well. I have a lot of listens and this and that. Not that I, you know, for me, to be honest, it's still a lot for anybody to be listening to my show. And I'm not saying I get a lot more than like five listens or something. It's not like that or something. But you see people that are getting thousands of listens to their show. And I'm not getting anywhere near that. So I look at that. I look at the time I put in trying to prepare, and at the same time, not having the time I would like to prepare. Because if this was my full-time job, I think the show would be 20 times better because I'd have all that time to put into it, as opposed to now, it's kind of a rush to put together. And anytime, I always have my phone, of course, and anytime I think of ideas, I write them down in a little notepad on my phone. So I'm constantly trying to think of things and ideas for shows. And I feel like the show has changed a bit in that it used to be a lot easier to come up with ideas for shows, and that the shows were a lot better. Now, that might be because in the past, I don't know how long it's been now, but I've been pretty much doing the show by myself, whereas before I had a co-host every night. So the way I approached the show was a lot different when I had somebody co-hosting with me compared to doing the show myself, which makes it a lot harder as well, because it's me having to fill that whole time. And then, as I was saying, Tuesday, I mean, that's not really a problem because I can talk and talk about stuff, but it is from an entertainment standpoint, because to just have to listen to me the whole time, and there's other people that do it, but most of them take calls, and I would take calls. My problem is not that I don't want to take calls. It's just I'm not getting any calls or anybody Skyping in. And part of that is the majority of listeners listen to it after. They don't listen to it live. They listen to it after the show airs. So that's unfortunate that when I'm doing it live, I'm not getting that amount of listeners. And even when I do, they're not people that are calling in. So that hurts the show in the sense that I have to totally fill that time. And that can, I'm sure, bore people. Or, you know, just listening to me talk through the whole show. But, and it puts more pressure on me because I want to, not that, as I said, that I can't talk through the whole show, but the ability to be entertaining the whole show is something different. The ability to talk the whole show, yeah, I can do that. But to be entertaining the whole show, sometimes I can be, I think, and sometimes I'm just off, and it's not as entertaining as some other shows. So I think about, why do I bother doing this? And when I was getting up, I'm like, I don't even want to get up. I want to, not that I didn't want to do the show. I enjoy doing the show. And that's one of the reasons why I do it, and it keeps me going. I don't think I could not do the show. That if I stopped doing it, it would be like a void in my life, to be honest. because I've been doing it for so long now, over a couple years, and it's allowed me to get all these ideas out. And that if I didn't do it, I feel like something would be missing. So, you know, there's even times where it's a Friday or a Monday and I feel like doing a show. You know, but I'm like, no, I shouldn't do one today. Let me stick to the days that I do it. And, you know, I guess I could always record a show and not record it live and then, you know, replay that show the next day. But I like the aspect of being able to broadcast live as well. So I know that people can listen to me, even though, as I said, most people don't. They listen to the archives, but they can go on and actually listen to me right now. While I'm speaking, it's just a cool concept. You know, anybody in the world, essentially, not that they do, but I've seen, and whether it was by accident or on purpose, I've seen in these the stats different countries listening and stuff like that. So that is pretty cool that you can look at it and see, okay, somebody in wherever is listening to the show, and or at least clicked on it for a minute and then maybe turned it off and said, fuck this. But they still, at least it can reach them, and it can basically reach anybody. And I know a lot of radio stations can do that now because they've gone, even though they're on the radio, they're also on the internet, and they, you know, some of them are on like local stations or on, what is that application? I want to say iTunes, but it's not iTunes. It's something Tunes, though. I have it on my phone. So a lot of stations are on there, like the actual local station. So they're starting to do that as well. Plus, all the local stations have their own websites, but I think people are more apt to go to an application with all these different radio stations than somebody's specific website. But I do question at times, you know, why bother? Does anybody care? Does anybody, you know, do I get through to people? And I get messages here and there, and when I do, it's great because to see that I actually, somebody enjoyed something or supported something or even, you know, learned something, it's definitely a positive thing. So those messages help, although I don't get a lot, but I still feel like I can't just stop fighting somehow. And that way for me is, you know, doing this show. And that's the type of thing that I do to fight back. And I think it's what fits me, as opposed to doing some protest, or which I think for the most part are meaningless, or not that I put people down for doing it. I mean, that's their thing, or whatever people are doing out there to fight back. For me, media is what fits me, and it's really what always has. I mean, I wanted to make movies, and that's what my bachelor's degree is in. That's what I went to school for. So I didn't plan on doing radio, although I did actually want to do it a couple years ago. I mentioned this before. Well, now it's more than a couple years ago. It's maybe 4 or 5 years ago, and do political shows. And I'm glad that I didn't, because I don't know what I would have said. But I would have, you know, still said the whole thing that the parties are the same and all of that shit, and had a lot of the same ideas, but I wouldn't have been to the point I am now. So, you know, I'd be comparing like old shows to, or people would, to newer shows, and like, okay, well, you changed on this, but I still think a lot of the things that I say now, I would have said then, but there are certain things that my opinions would have been different, to be honest. I would have been more of a, you know, libertarian than what I am now, which I will not define. I will just say that I believe, like I say at the beginning of the show, that if you don't hurt anybody or hurt any, bother anybody's I'm trying to think of the way you would say it, take anybody's property or steal anybody's property or anything like that, then you should be able to do whatever you want. And that's really what I mean, to summarize my beliefs, that's what it is. And I don't see the big problem with that and how that is such a radical idea, because it is. It's definitely become a radical idea. And I think a lot of that, I guess, comes from government, and government doesn't want that, because if that's what happens, government pretty much goes away, or at least is so small that it might as well go away. But it really minimizes any role of government. So, of course, they don't want to promote that in schools. They don't want to promote that, period. And we'll be talking a little about that today. So, I mean, the Republican and Democratic conventions have been going on. This week is the Democratic convention. It's still, I think tonight's the last night where Hillary, of course, speaks, and then Trump. And people, you know, you see people in the crowds, they're like slaves. They look like Nazis, you know, cheering for these people. And it doesn't even matter who wins. It's a rigged system. And really, it's just showing you, by watching these things and paying attention to the candidates, where the country is going to go. And they both stand for less freedom, more government control. And that is the whole goal of the powers that be. And both of them stand for that. And I don't know who's going to win, because I don't know who made a deal. Whoever they want to win is going to win. And somebody made a deal with the devil, I guess you could say. And, you know, I always think back to 2008 that Hillary made a deal. But, you know, things change and they can fuck her over if they want to. So this whole thing that how people can actually think that one vote, when you have 300 million people, over 300 million people. Now, granted, there's not 300 million people over 18, and then you take out convicted felons that states say can't vote, and then you take out, well, we won't take those out yet. So you take all those out, and then you have eligible voters, which is probably still 200 million or at least 150. And 150 million, I mean, what's the difference? 150, 300, it's still, your vote means nothing. And then you take out all the people that just don't vote. I mean, you're still going to have, I forget what the last election was, but, you know, it's something like 100 million or something. And to think that your vote really means anything is ridiculous. However, they twist it around and they try to make you think that if you don't vote, you have no right to criticize. And if you don't vote, you're bad and you know, all these things, right? And really, the people that vote are the fucking idiots. Because, at least for president, I won't say locally, but for president, no doubt. And it's already been picked for you, first of all. For people that are not part of a party, you've been chosen two people to vote for because there's no chance that another candidate can win because they rigged the system. So only these two people have a chance of winning, one of the two. And then even before that, even if you're a member of a party and they throw these fuckers in front of you that are all, you know, former congressmen or whatever, or people with money, and the average person can't run. I mean, they can go and fill out the paperwork, but no one's going to hear of them. And it's just so ridiculous. Anybody who thinks that it's not the whole federal government is not rigged, and your state government as well, but it's harder, at least, meaning you can't blame people as much for thinking their local government is rigged compared to, you know, the federal government. I mean, the federal government, there should be no fucking question that it's rigged. But you still have these people who believe in the system. They talk about change. They all want change. But every year, if we get the right people in, if we follow the Constitution, and that's for, I guess, the Republicans, and on the other side, if we follow this or do this, and every year more laws are passed, more freedom is taken away, while people get engaged in this bullshit, you look at the government media, I mean, it's what they've been covering the past 2 weeks. And really, it's been the most important thing. Who gives a fuck? I mean, it's like, it's totally professional wrestling. It's like professional wrestling if you combine that with the fucking Super Bowl. And I have doubts about football, professional football, even though I love football as a game, about it being rigged, not the whole thing being rigged, but certain things. Because you think of the longer the game goes on, the closer the score is, the more people are going to be tuned in. So all of these things, they come to mind, and it's, you know, does the coach at the end of the game talk to the other coach on the other team at times and try to rig things, or, you know, things like that. because you can't, I don't think with football that you could really rig it to like the extent that the federal government is. But I think there's little things. College, I think you're only going to see rigged if you're paying the players. Because, and that's why I love college football so much, is because of the fact that you got guys that are out there that are never going to play professional football. I mean, some of them may go to like the Canadian League or may play in another country. There's not a lot of football leagues around the world, because football to everybody is soccer, and football is mostly popular in America, and in Canada it is as well. They have the Canadian Football League. And then they have the little leagues where they had a league where Vegas had a team for about 3 or 4 years. And I think they won the championship almost every year, the Las Vegas Outlaws. And then they had a team, the WWE guy owned, either he started the whole thing or he owned one of the teams. But Vegas had a team there too, but they only lasted a year. He just, the way he did it was terrible. And it's sad that the NFL has a monopoly on football. But they pretty much do. There is Arena Football League, which I tried watching it. It's like once you get into NFL and college, and I mean, that's how the sport's played, even if you play, like I played Pop Warner. I mean, if you get away from the rules of football and you grow up with it and grow up watching it, and it's hard to get into something like arena football. But anyway, I'm kind of getting off topic here. But that's really what it is. It's like, if you took, and the reason I combine it with football is because if you took the hype of the Super Bowl, you know, how for a week or two they sit there and they talk to the players and they hype it up. And that's what they do for like a year and a half of the election, of the presidential election, really. And then they especially, of course, the last, you know, 6 months from the convention until the election, or the last, what it would be, 4 months, they totally hype it up. So it's the hype of the Super Bowl combined with the bullshit fakeness of professional wrestling, where everything's predetermined and rigged and already planned out what's going to happen. And that's how it is, and why people can't fathom that. I don't know. So I don't want to go too much into that. I wanted to mention it because I'm probably going to do a show on it at some point. And we've talked about it a little before, but I want to do a show where we go into a lot of detail on the federal government elections and the presidential election being at the forefront of that. But tonight, I really want to focus on the things that I think are the most important to freedom and that need to happen for us to have any kind of freedom. And as I said earlier, they are not going to happen through the system. There's no way. They're not going to change all these things. And if they were to change them, which again, they're not, because they're all controlled, it would have to be over years and years. I mean, it would have to be something over hundreds of years that these would change, in my opinion, to be honest. And when you have a government that has all the resources that they have, it's impossible, in my opinion. And again, I'm being, I guess, very negative, but it's impossible to get them to do any of these things. So one of there are some things that you can do on your own that you don't need the fucking government's permission to do. And you can do them legally. And I think they're very important. And that is the raising of kids. So I never realized really how important that was. I mean, I always thought it was important. But until I had Dana Martin on, who she is a radical unschooler and has been on a bunch of shows like Dr. Phil and Wife Swap and whatever, and practices radical unschooling. I think she has, five or six kids, whatever. I always had thought a lot about kids' rights even before that, because I remember how I felt as a kid and even as a teenager especially, and how kids didn't really have, and teenagers, it's really worse with teenagers because they have the mental capacity to realize all these things but not be able to do a lot about it, unless, of course, they want to end up beaten or in jail or, maybe not jail, but some home or something. Essentially jail, as we had talked about the judge who threw a bunch of kids in jail for money. But one thing that you can do is control the way you raise your kids. And government, can they do anything about it? Technically, yes, because they can bring CPS in. If CPS ever showed up at my door, I don't have any kids, but if I did, I would tell them to fuck off. I know a lot of people get scared by CPS and they feel that they have to let them in, and that if they don't, that it's going to make things worse. And I just, until they have some type of warrant, or I don't even know if that would be enough for me. I can't say until I'm in that position. But if it was just a CPS worker, assuming there were no police there, there's no way they're coming in my house or speaking to my kids or me. It's not going to happen. So, and if everybody did that, and if everybody, I mean, that's another agency. And that's where it gets, it's overwhelming. It's so, I mean, there's so many agencies that you have to fight against, that you have to try to get rid of and do something about, that it's overwhelming. It's just, like I said, the system, it's not going to be done through the system. I only see things changing that have to do with, things you can't do on your own, changing through noncompliance. That the people rising up and saying, look, you know what? Fuck this law, fuck that law, and fuck you. And outside of that, I don't see anything happening. And of course, you have to have a lot of people to do that to make any type of difference, unless you just want to die, to be honest. You have to have a large amount of people. Now, even in a large amount of people, percentage-wise, it doesn't have to be that many people. And I'm not saying do anything like has been going on in the past couple weeks. And, you know, I've talked about the Dallas and Baton Rouge shooting and how, you know, it's the end of the world. There's a war on police, which is a bunch of bullshit. It will die down, and probably the same amount of officers that were killed, maybe a little more, but a small amount more will get killed this year than in other years, but it won't really make a difference. And yes, it makes a difference to those specific officers, but I'm saying as far as the bullshit propaganda that they're trying to put out there, that there's a war on cops and hype that whole thing up, it's bullshit. So, again, the first thing is homeschool your kids. Teach them to think for themselves. That's why I don't believe in discipline, because I don't think you can do it and discipline your kids at the same time. You can teach them self-discipline. You can teach them that. And people have done this, and Dana Martin's an example of that. But you can teach them at a very early age, and I think that's the key. You teach them as early as you can so they grow up trusting you. They grow up wanting to listen to you, not because they're scared or not because they think they're going to get punished, but because the things that you have told them have turned out to be true or have turned out to help them. So I don't believe in punishing your kids. I believe in teaching them about self-ownership. So then when they're a teenager or they're old enough, I mean, kids are self-aware, very young. And, you know, even at 9, 10, 11, they start to know certain things that they want. I'm not saying that you don't stay heavily involved in their life. I think you have to be more involved in their life than if you're somebody who disciplines them all the time and does all this other shit. I think you have to be heavily involved in their life to help influence their decisions, but you don't force their decisions on them. You let them make their own decisions, but you become a very influential factor in their decisions. So then when they grow up to be independent thinking people. And you don't try to tell them this is how it is as far as, well, the government's fucked up. I mean, you can give them your opinion, but the goal isn't to try to brainwash them the same way that the government does. I mean, really, they'll see that for themselves. It's not hard if you're a person who can think for themselves. Now, that doesn't mean you can't teach them history and things that are proven facts that are on government documents or that are proven parts of or generally accepted events in history. But at the same time, you don't want to brainwash them either. Like religion, you know, I wouldn't bring my kids up with religion, but if they somehow find it on their own and that's what they want to do, then, hey, do what you want to do. It's your life. That's the whole point, that it's their life. So you're not just doing it for yourself or even society, because really that's who it's going to affect the most, society as a whole, because if everybody had free thinking kids, it would change things hugely. I don't know if that's a word, but what you're doing it for is for them to be able to make their own decisions and live their own life the way they want and for them to be happy. So you're doing it for them, but at the same time, it is also helping society as a whole, because they'll see those things. They'll see those things on their own. So that's something that you can do, that you don't need the government's permission. And anybody who has their kid in government school, I can't really comprehend that. And I've talked so many times about alternative ways, if both you and your husband work or you're a single parent, alternative ways to get your kid out of government school and to form groups with like-minded people and to get like-minded people to help you. So I've talked about that a whole bunch of times. So by now, you know, people should know. But there's that option also. If you don't have relatives, if you don't, I mean, especially with the internet, and, you know, you want to do research if you don't know the person that well, but it may be an established group already. But either way, you know, you want to do your due diligence on people if you don't know them that well, but, or if you join, you know, some kind of group. But there are ways if that's what you want to do. And school is really the number one enemy when it comes to kids. And what people understand is, don't understand either. They think, well, if you take your kids out of school and homeschool them, that's bad because school is good. And they push this down people's throats too, ram it down people's throats, that school, how good school is. It's not school, it's education. There's a difference. And you don't get education in school, not proper education, and not the education you should be getting. You shouldn't be in the same grade with people just based on age. You shouldn't have, you know, the structure that they have in school. It's totally set up for kids to be picked on and bullied. I mean, why do you think bullying goes on all the time? Well, because the structure of school is set up that way. Now, I'm not saying they set it up that way on purpose, but I'm saying you have an environment that is obviously bullying is going to come out of it. Kids fighting each other is going to come out of it. And as I talked about on Monday, you know, now you have police in schools that are arresting kids. And that's another thing that you have to deal with. So in my opinion, it's I can't see, you know, I know it's hard because you probably went to public school or even, you know, private school and want your kids to have that same experience, but most people didn't have a good experience. So before you think about that as a reason why, think about your experience in school. It's like, I know somebody who grew up, you know, picked on in school and made fun of, and, oh, but I want my kids to experience school. Well, really, like you did, you know, so the majority of people were not the popular kids. And even in that, there's a lot of kids that might have been picked on in elementary school. And I saw this through school and then became popular in high school or something. So most kids at some point in their life were bullied or picked on in school. But that is something you could do. And I'd love to see, you know, 20% of people on one day just take their kids out of school permanently and see how the government fucking reacted to that one. So that, I think, is very important. And not only is it very important, but it's something doable, easily doable, and not something you're going to get arrested for. Now, when we get into other stuff like noncompliance, you know, if you're not complying by the laws, yeah, you could easily get arrested for it. But when it comes to this, it's not something that you're doing wrong. Not that the other things, I believe, would be things you're doing wrong, but it's not something you're even doing wrong in the eyes of the government. Well, they might think what you're doing is wrong, but it's not illegal. And there's a difference, obviously. So I've been talking for about an hour. I'm going to take a break and play some clips. I have a whole bunch from the police because that's what we're going to get into next. And everything kind of revolves around them, because in order to accomplish anything, if you don't go through the system is going to try to stop you. And who are the ones who are going to try to stop you? Well, that's going to be the police, obviously. And of course, I'm not saying that you do anything violent or anything like that. And that's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is that the police are going to be the ones that are going to try to stop you. Well, not if you have enough people. When it comes to noncompliance, and if you have enough people, they can't arrest everybody. So that's where, you know. And if I thought it was even worth it, I'd say you could even talk to police and get them to understand what was going on, and then to really understand, you know. There's a lot of former police who actually believe this, so it's not out of the realm of possibility, but at the same time, that's the whole point, why they're former police and not current police. So, well, we'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And remember to listen to the Illumination Hour every Monday at 7 p.m. with host and producer Ellen Stallone, former co-host of Nonpartisan Liberty for All and Free Talk Live, which is a much bigger show, obviously, than Nonpartisan Liberty for All. But she is a seasoned radio host and has done a lot of shows. So be sure to listen to her first show, where she is able to do a show on her own. So we'll be right back after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Disability.
If you work in law enforcement, I have a very important question for you, one which soon may be a matter of life or death. I'm sure some people become police officers just so they can boss other people around. But I'm going to assume here that you mean well, that you want to be one of the good guys. In which case, my question is this. Is there anything the politicians could enact into law that you wouldn't enforce? Is there any order that you would refuse to carry out? Or will you do absolutely anything your bosses tell you to? In the U.S., police have already obeyed orders to fine or arrest people for a wide variety of harmless activities, such as dancing at the Jefferson Memorial or having a vegetable garden in their front yard. Police have even gone so far as to execute violent paramilitary raids on food co-ops and organic farms. For decades, police have been carrying out armed home invasions, forced property confiscations, and other acts of violence against people who weren't hurting anyone, but who engaged in behaviors or habits which lawmakers have arbitrarily declared to be illegal. You may be comfortable in assuming that you'll never receive an order to do something truly immoral. But the fact is, with every order you receive, you have a choice between obeying without question or relying on your conscience. No doubt there were cops a few years ago who never expected to be ordered to disarm innocent people, to do door-to-door home searches without warrant or probable cause, or to detain and interrogate people for merely driving down a road. Yet police have since been ordered to do all of these things, and almost without exception, they obeyed. So it's not unreasonable to ask, is there any point at which you will draw a line and say, no, that I will not do? And if you won't draw such a line anywhere, if you will do absolutely anything your political masters tell you to, how are you any different from the enforcers of Soviet Russia, Red China, or Nazi Germany? You may be tempted to say, I don't make the law, I just enforce it. Or to argue that if some legislature, court, or some authority above you says it's okay, then it must be. But keep in mind that this is exactly what the thugs of every tyrannical regime in history said to justify their actions. And how do we remember those people now? As courageous, noble law enforcers? No. Unless you want posterity remembering you as a heartless, mindless pawn of oppression, then you'd better decide, and decide now, where you will draw that line. Unfortunately, there's little indication that most cops have any line at all. The incidents of police officers refusing to inflict injustice upon the people are extremely rare. Even when cops say they personally oppose certain laws, such as marijuana prohibition, nearly all of them continue to violently enforce these laws against nonviolent people. In other words, they recognize these laws as counterproductive and unjust, but they choose to enforce them anyway. For the most part, American cops seem completely incapable of disobeying immoral orders, and instead do what the enforcers of every other authoritarian empire have done, inflicting harm on innocent people whenever and however those in power tell them to, while accepting no personal responsibility for their actions. I hope you are better than that. Keep in mind, there are a lot of decent Americans who do have the integrity and courage to draw a line in the sand, a point at which they will disobey and resist violations of their rights by those in power. It may be that they refuse to be disarmed. It may be that they refuse to cooperate with warrantless searches, or refuse to keep funding a government they view as destructive and unjust. Whether you agree with them doesn't particularly matter. What does matter is whether, in the end, you are willing, if and when you are ordered to do so, to violently assault the dissenters for their disobedience. When they draw their line in the sand and stand their ground, and your supervisors tell you to use whatever level of violence necessary to get submission and compliance from the resistors, will you obey? If it came down to it, would you kill American citizens for disobeying politicians? Now, if someone is actually harming someone else, of course you have the right to use whatever force necessary to stop the attacker and protect the innocent. But that would be the case even if you had no badge and no uniform. But when you try to arrest someone who hasn't threatened or harmed anyone else, but has only disobeyed some arbitrary regulation, then you are the one initiating force. You are the one starting a fight. You are the bad guy. Now remember, the American Revolution was people forcibly resisting gun confiscation, warrantless searches, what they viewed as unfair taxation, and a number of other oppressions. All in the name of law, all carried out by law enforcers. If you had lived back then, would you have been among the rebel colonists, the ones who refused to be disarmed, refused to pay taxes, and resisted warrantless detainment and searches? Would you have sided with the signers of the Declaration of Independence, or would you have been among the redcoats, the law enforcers, assaulting, caging, or killing any colonists with the gall to disobey the king? And which side are you on today? Of course, the message you'll get from your superiors, the politicians, and your fellow officers is that it's not your place to decide which laws to enforce, and that as long as you faithfully follow orders, that you can't be held personally responsible for doing as you're told. But that is a lie, a horribly dangerous lie. At the Nuremberg trials, it was established that the excuse used by the Nazi law enforcers that they weren't to blame and shouldn't be punished because they were just doing as they were told did not relieve them of personal responsibility for their actions. And make no mistake, if you choose to blindly obey unjust commands, and one day your intended victims decide to fight back, saying that you're just doing your job will not make you bulletproof. It may be your own life you save by deciding now at what point you will choose to be a moral, responsible human being instead of just an obedient pawn of those in power. Ultimately, only you can answer the question of where you will draw that line. But really, the only moral, rational answer is this. If something would be wrong for you to do without a badge, then you shouldn't do it with one either. The idea that uniforms and legislation can give you special rights is both false and horribly dangerous. Nearly every large-scale injustice in history was committed by people who wrongly imagined that their position of authority made it okay for them to do things that other people have no right to do. Like everyone else, you have the right to use force to stop attackers and protect the innocent, and when you do that, you are the hero. But you have no right to be the attacker, even if it's your job, and even if the aggression is called law. Always, in every situation, you and you alone are responsible for what you do. Wearing a badge and a uniform and doing whatever you're told does not make you brave and noble or deserving of any respect. Just following orders is a coward's excuse. If your job requires you to assault or cage people who haven't threatened or harmed anyone, then quit. Being an actual protector, doing the right thing no matter what anyone else says, even if it means disobeying orders and breaking the law, that takes courage and integrity. That makes you a hero. So, do you have enough of a spine to draw that line? Decide now before your failure to think for yourself results in damage that cannot be undone.
All of them should be held responsible because the police officers, the good ones, as they say, they don't testify against them. So they're all bad. If you're a part of that gang, you need to quit your job.
Wow, a slap in the face to law enforcement just days after an NYPD cop was killed in cold blood, who, by the way, was African-American. Hundreds descending upon the streets of Midtown Manhattan to march against cops and even chant expletives for those who protect and serve, and were protecting them on that day, too. Here now to discuss where we go from here, Fox News contributor and former homicide detective Rod Wheeler, who was out and got those sound bites for us and did all those interviews, and Milwaukee County Sheriff David Clark. Since we spoke to you, Rod, earlier, let's get the sheriff to weigh in. Sheriff, your reaction to some of the sentiment you heard on the streets on Saturday.
Well, it's just crazy talk. That's ignorance in its purest form. You know, I think we need to rethink this strategy. I don't know why the police even bother policing those demonstrations. They're not protests. Those people advocate for the overthrow of our legally constituted government.
What I would do is
let them fend for themselves. Let the good law-abiding people of New York clash with them for disrupting their lives, disrupting their businesses. Then the police can show up and arrest these subhuman creeps for creating a disturbance. That we can do.
Now, Rod, do you have a difference since you're actually on the street talking to them? Number one, did the cops play an important role in keeping them safe? And you tell me about the sentiment you heard.
They did, Brian. I mean, the cops were out there. You know, I must say that the police were taking a lot of verbal abuse while they were out there, and it was really unfortunate. But I also must say that the police did not turn their backs on the citizens. And even the people that had the biggest mouths out there, the folks that I was talking to, if they were to call those police officers today, those same police officers would still be there to assist them. Look, Brian, it was just last week when a young New York police officer was gunned down in cold blood right here in this city where I'm at now.
I want to bring in now Steve Loomis, detective with the Cleveland Police Department and the president of the Cleveland Police Patrolmen's Association. And Steve, before we get to you, I want to kind of set the scene here. We're in Cleveland for the Republican National Convention, and it has been your task to make sure that people coming here at this venue and all throughout the city are safe. So I first want to get your thoughts on what's happening in Baton Rouge and then how it might affect here. You're with us?
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Absolutely heart-wrenching watching what's going on in Baton Rouge right now and the reasons behind it. You know, this all began the Dallas police officers being ambushed and murdered. Now in Baton Rouge, it looks like that's the same thing. This all began with a 911 call from an African-American male saying that another African-American male was pointing a gun at him. Those officers responded. That male didn't comply and tragically ended up losing his life over that with a gun in his pocket. This is how this began. the President of the United States validated a false narrative and the nonsense that Black Lives Matter and the media are pressing out there to the public, validated it with his very divisive statements, and now we see an escalation. This has got to end. We need some leadership in this country to come forward and put an end to this. I don't care if it's clergy, I don't care who it is, but somebody's got to step up and put an end to this, because it's the false narrative and very influential people that are politicizing the false narrative. Absolutely insane that we have a president of the United States and a governor of Minnesota making the statements that they made less than one day after those police-involved shootings. And those police-involved shootings, make no mistake, are what absolutely has triggered this rash of senseless murders of law enforcement officers across this country. It is reprehensible. And the President of the United States has blood on his hands and it will not be able to come washed off.
You know, I hear the emotion in your voice. We heard it from the Lieutenant Governor of Texas, Dan Patrick, right after what happened there with five police officers killed in Dallas just a few days ago. And now we have this situation. I want you to talk about the fact that here in Cleveland, Officer Loomis, we have hundreds of police officers coming from all over. Does this change this venue in any way? And I want to be careful about the language that we use and not take this to an even more incendiary level, but it is what it is. You have a lot of police officers coming here.
We have a lot
of police
officers.
And they are targets.
Absolutely, they're targets. And this is proof positive that they're targets. Our legal staff right now is drafting a letter to Governor Kasich. We are asking for him to take emergency action to ban any weapons, open carry weapons, in Cuyahoga County for the next week, because anybody that's going to have an open carry weapon is going to be treated and looked at in a hostile type environment. In this environment where police officers are being ambushed and murdered, anybody that has an open carry gun, we are going to look at, and we are going to look at very, very hard. And Governor Kasich needs to step up and seize the moment and take care of this issue with some type of order or whatever he needs to do to outlaw or ban open carry weapons here. I don't know what the details in Baton Rouge are, but I can tell you and assure you that anybody having a weapon on their arm or weapon slung over their shoulder is going to be looked at in a much, much different light than we would normally look at, given the circumstances and what this country's going through. How the hell did we ever become the bad guys in this country? I cannot imagine how we got there. It's the irresponsible reporting of the media, and it's the irresponsible statements of people that are credible, like the President of the United States, like celebrities. If you're blessed with celebrity and you're blessed with talent, then use that celebrity for good and not evil. And what
I
do we
hear
do?
You.
We have actors out there spewing venom. We have singer-songwriters spewing venom. We have athletes up here in Cleveland. We had an athlete that did something, you know, that he since has apologized for, so I don't want to go down that road with him. But use your power. We have to come together on this. So every corner of this country
needs
to come together.
It's interesting because this then begins to step into the ground of politics when you talk about the Second Amendment rights and banning open carry in a state where it is the law, even
Absolutely.
If it's for a particular time of a period of time throughout this. So that will be at that level. About the governor, that will be a political and a public safety issue to kind of toggle back and forth with. And what you're asking is that they actually begin that dance and begin to talk about it. Before I let you go, I want to talk about securing a venue knowing that police are targets, and not just any venue, but it's our democracy on display for the world. We are blessed to have police officers come and give their time and energy and expertise to keep all of us safe here. It looks much like a military installation right now. I mean, I saw the fortification even before this happened as I arrived at the venues this morning in downtown Cleveland. You're from here. You police here. Your challenge now going forward.
Well, that is a challenge going forward. History has shown us that we have to fortify the city if we don't want it to be trashed by a bunch of people that have no business being here, breaking our stuff and throwing rocks at us, and now murdering us. You know, we have history has shown the policies and the procedures that we're employing here in Cleveland and probably in Philadelphia next week are written in the blood of our brothers and sisters, are written in lessons learned historically at these RNCs and these DNCs. And this is an absolute tragedy that this is a state of affairs in the United States of America where the police officers are the enemies, and they're the enemies again because a four-time convicted felon who's got a gun in his pocket didn't comply with the police officers of Baton Rouge. And the President of the United States had very divisive words to say about that.
Mm-hmm.
And it is an absolute travesty, and I can't imagine a worst-case scenario for the men and women. I'm going to have 600 Cleveland police officers out here at the RNC.
I know.
We're going to have another 2,300 officers that are coming in from all over the country to help us with this. This is a great country. This is the only place in the world where you can come and you can say what it is that you want to say. And we defend the Second Amendment, and we defend the Constitution and the rights of people to be able to say, freely say whatever it is that they want to say. And let me tell you something. The new Black Panther Party and the Black Lives Matter movement that were down protesting in front of 3rd District here in Cleveland last night, they weren't saying very nice things. And they were saying things that were insightful, and they were saying things that were very threatening about what they want to do to police officers and taking over the district and everything else. So I don't want to hear this peaceful protest nonsense either. There's nothing peaceful about that. You cannot, in this country, you can't go into a theater and scream fire.
Just one of my homes, two way. Hey, Snoop, what up? This your nigga Dre out there to suck my motherfucking dick.
For the nigga who be talking loud and holding his dick, talking shit, he better lay low.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. I know cops are fucking stupid, but the reason for everything that's happened is not one person getting shot. And anybody who actually intelligently studies the issue knows that 3 to 4 people a day get shot by and killed by the police. So, and this has been going on for a long time. It's not just been going on for a couple of years when the media decided to finally cover what's been going on. I'm sure it's been going on for 100 years or 50 years. It's you know, who knows how long police have been killing people that are unarmed, that they have no right to kill. But I guarantee you it's from when they got badges that it's been going on. And really, it didn't start getting reported on to the extent that it is now. And it's still not really getting reported on because there's been about 6, maybe 7 national stories about people being killed by police in 2 years when the number in 2 years is more closer to 3,000. Not every single one of those people were unarmed, but you don't know what the real story is because all you know is what the police tell you, and they always lose their if they have cameras, they always tend to lose them or they break or whatever. So getting back to what we were talking about before the break and getting into the police part of it, one of the things that has to happen, in my opinion, for the police to stop what they're doing is the end of the police altogether as we know them, meaning that there is no more an organization called the police that is backed by the government. or that has anything to do or with or any connection to the government, period. That it is not the government's job to protect people. That it is their job to find protection. Now, I know saying it, especially saying it that way right off the bat, a lot of people are going to disagree with me. However, there are a lot of other ways to protect people and to keep them safe. Because that is the goal here. And I've been talking about this for I don't know how long. But the goal is to protect people and keep them safe. The goal of the government police is to generate money, fill up prisons. I mean, 95% of what they do, besides generate what they call revenue, you know, via extortion for the state, the county, is to fill the prisons, to put people down and degrade them, to teach obedience and teach you that you must obey the government, to arrest people that have warrants, whether they're for serious stuff. Usually it's because they didn't pay a ticket or appear in court for something stupid, to violate people's rights, harass, assault, and even murder them, and enforce ridiculous laws instead of using their discretion that they can use and stop enforcing the ridiculous laws and focus on the murderers and the property crimes and things like that where you actually have a victim. And, of course, to kidnap people off the street for committing no crime because you have the right. We've talked about self-ownership and everybody owns themselves, even though I mentioned this last week, that if you ask a person who owns you, I guarantee you 90%, maybe more, would say that they own themselves. Although at the same time, they'd say that the police still have the right to arrest them for possession of drugs. If you own yourself, you have the right to put what you want in your body. So if the police arrest you for possessing a substance, that is kidnapping. That is a crime. All police are criminals, okay? And you have a majority of the population that don't understand that, can't even comprehend that, and do nothing but defend police. Or even the people that speak out against them, they say, well, you know, I don't hate police and I still want police to be around. I just don't want them to do this. Most of what I hear, I don't hear a lot of we need to get rid of them. I did hear or read somebody say that. I'm like, finally, somebody actually says we need to get rid of the police. Obviously, if something doesn't work, if something is worse for a community than better, then why have it? And I know the first thing out of people's mouths that defend the police is, well, what would you do if there weren't police? You'd be crying to whoever and you'd be. No, I wouldn't even hire a security company. I would just stay fucking, you know, strapped all the time. So I would defend myself. But people would know there are security companies, there's security walking around and stuff like that. And, you know, I don't think that. And if I take the model in Detroit, the Detroit Threat Management Center, I don't think that they would just watch somebody sit there and get beaten or watch somebody get murdered or raped or anything like that. In fact, I know they wouldn't. So assuming that the security companies were designed in that fashion and trained in that same fashion, there'd be no problem at all. Now, I'm looking at it from their perspective, knowing what they do. So if you had a whole bunch of Detroit threat management centers around the country, and people actually knew what they did, they would be wanting them over the police in 2 seconds. I guarantee it. Of course, they don't know anything about them because, one, they might just not know about them because the media doesn't cover them except for independent media like me and Cop Block. And I need to call, I kind of mentioned this, that Dale Brown was going to come back on the show, who is the owner and creator, I guess, of the concept of the whole thing, is going to come on the show. But we talked about maybe doing some collaboration as well regarding the media on the radio. Not that I'm going to go out and be a security guard in Detroit or anything, but I couldn't do what they do. I see their workouts and all that stuff. I mean, I guess if I got trained, I could. But and when I was younger, I know I could. But I don't know about now. But anyway, I'm kind of probably out of shape. You know, I could fight, but that probably isn't going to last too long. But that's what they try to avoid, fighting. It's more about disarming that person. And I don't necessarily mean disarming, taking a gun out of their hand. It's incapacitating them. But that's where people don't think of the other options. You don't need police. And the main difference is that the security companies, or whether you defend yourself or whether communities get together and form their own group to defend their community, however it is done, they don't have the special rights of the police. So they don't have the right to just go and kill people and any of that. They have the same rights that any other person would have. And the police have all these extra rights. And that is the problem. And no one is going to resolve that problem, because no politician is going to take rights away from the police. If anything, they're trying to give them more rights. 2 shootings and they're trying to give them more rights. Which is crazy, but all these people get killed and they do nothing. So it's really, you know, it's really fucked up. And politicians have always been supportive of police and kissed the ass of police. So how do you do that? I don't know, because you don't do it through the system. The other thing, I mean, one way of getting things done is making the government irrelevant. So one of the ways is you don't call police anymore, first of all. You stop calling police and people start defending themselves and start hiring the security companies. And, you know, somebody like Dale, who wants to expand, maybe have a one in every major city or something like that. That's where the public turns against the police. They think what's going on now is turning against the police. That's not turning against the police. It's noncompliance and it's not using them. So noncompliance in that, you know, you get a ticket, you don't pay your fucking ticket. You pretty much ignore the fucking police. And you get to the point where, if there is security companies, you have them protect you. Now, whether they would protect you from the police or not, that's a whole nother story. But you try to do everything you can to make them irrelevant, along with not complying with their bullshit. Now, if there were a bunch of people that stopped complying, then, you know, they can't do anything about it. They really can't. If it's one or two people, that's where they can, you know, they have too many police officers and too many weapons and all of this stuff to do anything. And I'm not saying to actually do anything physically, but I'm saying that if it's a whole group of people, they wouldn't have to do anything. The police just couldn't, there'd be too many people, so they couldn't arrest everybody, as opposed to if you're by yourself, the police are not going to back off you because they have all of this backup and all of these things and all of that. They're not going to say when you don't comply that, oh, that's okay. No, they're maybe going to kill you or bring you to jail or whatever. So noncompliance is all based on the concept of having a certain amount of people not comply. And then if you have to defend yourself, and this is the only thing that I do agree with. I don't agree with fucking people that snipers that are killing police or killing police, period. But I do believe in self-defense. So if you're being attacked by a government agent, I believe you have the right to defend yourself. And that is something that a lot of people disagree with. They think that the police should be able to do whatever they want. I don't. I believe you have the right to defend yourself. I don't, however, believe you have the right to just randomly kill somebody, whether it's police or a person or whatever. You know, it's... you're talking about people's lives, and it, when you get to that, it's, you know, you can't take that back. It's not like getting in a fight or something. And I do understand where those people were coming from, but I don't condone it or agree with it. It's not something that I think is the way to go or fair to the, you know, some of these guys are, I mean, I look at them as a gang and they've all kidnapped people, but they don't deserve to die just because, I mean, some of them that have actually killed people may, I don't know, but you know, to randomly do that is not okay. And I understand where they're coming from because they're thinking possibly, either they're nuts or they're thinking, you know, what are we supposed to do? And I think a lot of people are thinking that they're feeling that frustration, not just the people that are looking at it from a media-based distortion like Black Lives Matter. that it's about police killing black people, but it's about the government killing people, the government taking away your freedoms, the government oppressing people. And that's where it's going. So being that you can't do it through the system, the only way, like I said, really, I believe is noncompliance. But I think the police should, government police should be eliminated altogether and get different jobs. But that is something that the people would have to force. And I think, again, doing as much as you can to make government, not just police, but government itself irrelevant, because it's like a business. If you can't, you know, if you don't have any customers, you go out of business. Now, the one difference, of course, with government is they can print money and they can extort money from you. So the more people that stop paying taxes, then the government won't be able to fund themselves. They'll be able to print money, but eventually that money's going to be worthless. And I think it's going to be worthless way before that happens anyway. One of the bigger things that's not going to, I don't believe, hurt anybody, because ideally I don't want to see people, whether they're police or just regular people, get hurt. I don't. Regardless of what people may think, you know, you do what you have to do to defend yourself, and you do what you have to do. You have a line that if it gets crossed, you have to do what you have to do to have some kind of freedom. I mean, you can't just get to the point where you're just a slave and do nothing about it. I'm not saying we're at that point now, but what I'm saying is that I don't believe that you can let it get to that point on one side, but I don't want to see people get hurt. However, it seems like the reaction by the government is always on the side of the government, of course, not the people. So will it get to a point where you have the people having more and more incidences with the government? That's very possible, and I hope that doesn't happen. But I hope most of things like this can be done by, like I said, not using police and not complying with ridiculous laws. And hopefully police, realizing what the fuck they're doing, instead of being these ignorant, well, at least all their spokesmen are ignorant fucking jackasses with attitudes that think that they rule the world. And you see it in every single video. You see it so many times. It's ridiculous. Anyway, one of the biggest things, though, that would limit the power of the police without hurting anybody. Now, I know people will disagree about the hurting people, because they'll say it will hurt people in a different way, is the legalization of all drugs. And people say it will hurt people that use drugs. No, it won't, because it's not going to change anything. The people that use drugs will continue to use drugs. The people that don't won't. It doesn't matter if they're legal or not. But that will take a lot of power away from the police. I saw our video again today that, oh, well, we smell marijuana. So they won't be able to pull that bullshit anymore. and say, we smell marijuana or we need to search your car. They won't, at least not for drugs. Now, they'll probably come up with other ways to violate your freedoms. And they're doing it on a daily basis by listening in on phone calls and collecting all the data. People forget about that. I haven't heard all of it. I heard some of it, but I've heard recaps and stuff like that. I haven't heard anybody say shit about data collection. I've just heard more security and more this and more that. And that's why it doesn't matter who's president. First of all, they'd never get to the point they are now if the powers that be didn't want them to. They'd never get the nomination, number one. Number two is they both want less freedom, more government control. They want to spy more on people. They want to continue to collect data, collect more data, all of these things. They never even fucking come up anymore. I rarely hear them talked about. All I hear is the opposite. I hear more security, like with Trump and even with fucking Hillary. You hear more. That's why, you know, it doesn't matter who becomes president anyway. But I don't know who they've picked, but whoever they've picked, they made a deal with. Now, for them, it would probably be best if it was Trump, if they could have made a deal with Trump, because people are going to think, oh, you even have Alex Jones saying how Trump is going to, you know, like basically save the world from the globalists and all this bullshit. It's not going to happen. I'm sorry. That's a bunch of bullshit. And the fact that he has all of these people that believe his bullshit is crazy. So I don't know. I don't know how anybody can be for or support or sit there and root and scream for a fucking ruler, for somebody to rule them. I want this person to rule me. It's insane. So the legalization of drugs, which, yes, it's happening with marijuana, but I don't ever see it happening with everything. And it's definitely, it will be controlled. They'll still have agencies that will control it, just like they have the ATF right now. It's not going to become like it should. Like I had said, it should be like it was before 1914. And so should guns, for that matter. So if you got rid of the police, you legalized all drugs, so that takes away a bunch of things you'd need police for any fucking way. So you'd have security to just really focus on protecting people and keeping people safe. And I'm talking real security, not like the fuckers at the mall. Look up the Detroit Threat Management Center. And you'd have the amount of people in prisons be greatly reduced to pretty much murderers, rapists, and I don't think people that commit property crime should be in jail. It depends how bad it is, what they do. But for the most part, if they're not armed, they should have to replace what they stole. But this whole jail mentality has to change. The whole prison system has to change. The whole judicial system has to change. So, and this is just really the start of kind of organizing some of these ideas as to, you know, I have all these ideas and what I believe in, but organizing them into a logical plan, or a not plan, but a logical list and putting them together and how they interact with each other. Just like, you know, if you have the legalization of drugs, then you get rid of all the police and you go to private security and things like that. Because legalization of drugs is going to cut crime at least in half. And then you look at other things. So by getting basically to, as long as you don't physically attack anybody or kill anybody or rape anybody, you know, anything to violate their body or their property, then you do whatever you want. What the fuck do you need police for, really? Except you need people to go after the people that have done those things. However, if you prevent it in the first place by having security, and not security that's going to arrest you for doing other things, they're going to focus on protection and things like that, and protection of your property. So anything else you do, they're not going to give a fuck. At the same time, if you change the laws where all of that's, everything was legal except crimes against people and crimes against property, it really wouldn't matter anyway. So those, it's like one thing leads to the next thing. You know, you change these laws and it leads to this. However, again, these laws are not going to be changed through the system. So with drugs, it's the same thing. It's noncompliance. It's people that do drugs say, fuck it, and they do them anyway. Now, the problem with drugs is that it creates crime. And as the problem with drugs being illegal, it creates crime. So how do you create a black market that doesn't create the crime and keeps the price down? That's the other thing. Even if you could do something that doesn't create crime, like the Silk Road did, where you buy everything on the internet, the prices are still too high because it's illegal. And that's where we have a problem. Whether you don't comply or not, that in order to eliminate all that crime of property crime and people stealing and robbing to get money for drugs, the price has to be lowered. Legalization would do that, but without legalization, it wouldn't. So that's where finding and coming up with different ideas on how to get the, I mean, one of them would be to essentially grow everything in the U.S. And I think you could grow everything, and you can definitely grow weed in the U.S. I don't know about coca leaves. That would be pretty hard. But at the same time, you're still going to have the violence of other people, because you're going to have to protect it. And it's, there's a lot of things that go into that. So, however, I don't have all the answers, and I'm not going to sit here and say that I do have all the answers, because I don't. However, I think that I have some good ideas. I know how to get to or what freedom is and what liberty is and how things should be. It's just how do you get there is part of the problem, and how do you maintain that, and how do you get by the government without using the system, because it's not going to go through the system. They're not going to, you know, maybe in 100 years they'll legalize some of these drugs. I don't know. But it's a means of control of them, and they don't want to give of control of people, and they don't want to give that up. They want that control. And drugs is a means of control, just like them creating terrorism and then being able to control people that way. So thanks, everybody, for tuning in. My last thing is basically, you know, do what you can school-wise, parent-wise, because that's not something that, you know, is illegal. And we got to get to a level of getting government out of our lives as much as possible by not using them and doing what we can to eliminate as much as government as possible by not using it. Now, that's going to take a lot of people and coming up with ideas, preferably ideas in which, you know, are peaceful. But again, you know, you draw that line, how far are you going to go? You know, if they drew a line with Hitler, you know, maybe things would have been a lot different. So thanks, everybody. Have a good night.